Hello students, I hope you all are absolutely safe and fine out there, and I also hope that you are preparing really, really well for your upcoming board exams. So today I'll be discussing the do's and don'ts as far as your English language paper is concerned, and I'll be speaking about the various suggestions that have also been mentioned in the official website. So without wasting further time, let us quickly proceed further with our analysis as far as English language paper is concerned. Now, as you can all see, this is the very first question. Now, in the first question, which is going to be asked for 20 marks, you cannot spend more than 30 minutes on this question. Remember one thing, the moment you are exceeding your time in this particular question, your other questions are going to be affected. So be very careful about this. Now you have a story, you have an option of a story, you have three different types of essays, that is a narrative, descriptive, argumentative, and then you also have a picture study. Okay, so you have to select any one out of it, and whatever you prefer writing the most, go ahead with that. Now, whenever you write an essay or you write a story, or a picture composition, just for your better performance in the content, I would suggest you all can actually make a planner. Now, what you can simply do is you can just plan your entire content, like what will be the introduction. If it's a story, then who are going to be the characters, what is going to be the plot, what is going to be the theme and the background of your story. And if it's an essay, so accordingly you have to give it an introduction, body and a conclusion. So it will always be better if you make a planner and then you write down the essay. So that is going to help you save a lot of time in thinking. Like what happens is when we are writing a paper and we're just abruptly starting with the content. So you end up thinking and then you waste a lot of time in that process. So when you plan your content really well, you are actually going to save a lot of time. So the only suggestion over here is plan your essay, plan your content, and then start writing. You will have an easy flow of content. Okay, now let's have a look at certain suggestions. Now you have to focus on writing an original story. Do not try copying the theme or the idea from any textbook or poetry, or for that matter, even your drama. Remember, it has to be an original story. Okay, always make use of dialogues if you're writing a story. That is actually going to help enhance your content. Okay, if it's an argumentative essay, remember you have to express your views and you have to give justifications. You have to prove your pointer as to why exactly you're saying and why it is correct. Right, so you have to give sufficient examples to prove your point. Avoid repetition of words. Okay, if you suppose make use of the word happy, so again and again stop using the word happy everywhere. Somewhere you can use the word elated. Okay, at certain places you can also make use of the word like excited. So avoid repetition of words. Avoid repeating the same sentences, avoid repeating words now, that is in every content. Now, if you're writing a story, also if you're writing an essay or you're writing a picture composition, you have to avoid repetitive words. Okay. Planning, as I've told you, 4 to 5 main pointers should be, built in order to, help you go in a flow with your content. Right. Conclusion of any content that you write is very, very important. You cannot leave your essay, you cannot leave your story, you cannot leave your picture composition in an open-ended manner. You will have to conclude it properly. And let me tell you, only a properly concluded content gets marks. So if you feel that you're just going to leave it an abrupt ending, just the way you'll have a story called Face in the Dark, if you think you're just going to leave an abrupt ending and you're going to get marks, that's not going to happen. You have to build your vocabulary. You have to build your vocabulary words. Now, how does that happen? Read, and repeat. Read, and repeat. You need to understand the importance of reading even at this point of time. how can you improve your vocabulary? Just pick up a newspaper, read it for 10 minutes. Probably you might have got new words. Try searching for them in the dictionary, understand the meaning, and then use them in your sentences. That's how you build your vocabulary. The process is very simple. You read a newspaper, you come across a few new words, make a note of them, look up in the dictionary, see what these words mean, and then try using them in your content. Your vocabulary is built. And this entire process will not take more than 20 minutes. Not more than 20 minutes. How much time does reading an article in the newspaper take? Barely anything. So rather than, you know, investing your time in mobile phones and wasting your time out there, I would only suggest that pick up a newspaper and start reading. That is actually going to help you, build your vocabulary. Okay. Now, another thing that you all need to remember is that you cannot memorize essays, you cannot memorize stories, you cannot memorize picture composition. If you tell me that you are going to, just rotify your content and probably then you're going to write it in the paper, in English, that is not possible. Yes, you may read an essay and go, you may read an essay 5 times, 10 times, you might remember the plot and you might just go and write the same thing. That's a different thing. But rotifying an essay, that is not the option here. Do not mug up. I repeat, do not mug up essays. Do not mug up stories. You read them, you copyright them, get an idea of them. Probably you can use similar idea in your own content, but do not copyright or memorize an essay and write the same thing in the exam if the question comes. If you're really lucky, the essay that you've, memorized so well and that comes in the examination, you're not going to just blindly write it down. You need a content of your own. So always remember, you cannot memorize essays, you cannot memorize stories, you cannot memorize picture composition. It has to be your original. And this is where we judge your creativity, how creative you are when it comes to writing skills. Okay, now whenever you're attempting a narrative essay or a descriptive essay, so what you can simply do is, if you feel you've made a use of a good phrase or a good proverb or a very interesting word, just highlight that word with a pencil. Do not highlight anything with a pen. It is always preferable to highlight it with a pencil. Okay, you can highlight phrases, you can highlight, a new word that you have used in order to bring it to the attention of your paper corrector. Yes, you can do that. In fact, you are encouraged to do that. Highlight all these, basically your proverbs and phrases if you have made use of any. That will help you enhance your content. Another thing, avoid cancellation. Okay, avoid cancellations. We do not need, scribbling in the paper. If you believe that you've made an error, just one single line is enough. Remember, your presentation carries marks. Okay? Your presentation carries marks. So please ensure that you are not cancelling anything. Even if you're cancelling, just one stroke is enough. Clear? Let's proceed further then. Let's talk about the marking scheme here. So a short story must be centered around something that was kept a secret for a long time, and in the end you have revealed the suspense. Just the way we watch a horror movie or we watch a thriller movie. So, in the beginning, towards the end also we are hooked on to our seats. We're just not ready to move. Why? Because the content is so interesting. Exactly in the same manner you have to write your story. You cannot disclose the element of surprise somewhere in between and just end the story there. Your surprise or suspense should be towards the end. Okay, if you can carry humor, attempt writing certain humorous sentences also in your story. That will also help you gain marks. But remember, when you're writing a story, keep an element of surprise or suspense towards the end. Do not disclose it in the beginning only. Then when we talk about argumentative essays, remember, view is when you're talking for the topic, against when you're talking against the topic. So always remember, whenever you are arguing with someone, you have to give enough proofs for your pointers. This is the same thing you'll have to remember here also. You have to give logical pointers towards your content. If you say something, then you have to prove it why what you are saying is absolutely correct. Okay, so always remember that, give proper examples to prove your argument, and you should have a clear stand towards your opinion. Okay, then when we talk about a descriptive composition, you have to, you know, choose each and everything very carefully. Like, you know, what part of the day is your content based on? Then where is it where it is based on? Who are you talking about? What is this essay all about? You have to give a brief description of each and everything. Okay, always remember, a descriptive essay simply means describing something in detail. Okay, then when we talk about a narrative essay, remember, a narrative essay is an essay entirely based on you, so you are the protagonist. Okay, so always remember, whenever you are attempting a narrative essay, you have to be the lead character of your content, and your entire story should be based on you only. So your entire essay, your entire content should be based on you. It's as if you, like I, for example, should be the first person talking about, like, this happened with me, I did this, I went here, I went there. So it is I. Okay. And picture composition, now always remember, it's a picture, different people can have different perspectives. So always try accepting a very generalized interpretation to the picture. Okay. Whatever you feel relevant, okay, is in the picture, try describing that in detail. Talk about it. Maybe you can, you know, share a similar incident like that, or you can just put up an own story of that related to that picture only. So this is exactly what is picture composition. It can have different interpretations, like different people can interpret it differently. So you have a generalized interpretation. Don't go with a narrowed interpretation. That's what I'll just tell you all for picture composition. So this is your question number one. Remember, do not spend more than 30 minutes on this. Where are the places you lose marks? First and foremost is your presentation. You have to keep your paper neat. You have to ensure that you are not making spelling mistakes. And even if you're making spelling mistakes, one simple line, one simple scratch is more than enough. Please do not scribble it. Okay. Divide your content into paragraphs. Okay. It can be up to 5 paragraphs. That's absolutely okay, because your body paragraph would become really very big if you end up writing in one full paragraph. So simply what you can do is you can divide it into 5 paragraphs. That's okay. Divide your content well, present them neatly. Okay. The length of the page that you can write is 2 pages. Okay. 2 pages. Your content should be at least of 2 pages. It should look, you know, that as if you've written really well. And remember, a well-written content is where you present it really well. So focus on the presentation. Try using good vocabulary in your content. That will also help you increase marks in that. Okay, let's proceed further now. Now, this is just one example of an essay. So if you all can just see how the planner is written, it is called as an essay map. Then you can see how the title is given. Okay, one very important thing. If we do not read a book without a title, then definitely we cannot write an essay or a story without a heading. Your heading, your title is really very important when it comes to your first question, that is writing skills. So it needs to have a topic. Then see how well it is. Each and every paragraph is defined by leaving one line after every paragraph, starting from the margin. Please do not leave 2 finger space and then start writing. You can simply start from the margin and then you can go ahead with your content. Okay, this is exactly how an ideal essay should look. See, there are no cancellations everywhere. The handwriting is also a little big, so it looks a little neat. And then in the end, if you have the time, you can just put a bracket of the number of words that you've written. Even an approximate number is okay. You do not need to sit and count each and every word. Okay, an approximate count is also absolutely fine. So this is exactly how your first question should look in the paper. Now proceeding further. When we come on to question number two, so you're basically you're writing a letter. Now in letter writing also you have two options, right? One is a formal letter and the second one is an informal letter. Now, let's go step by step when it comes to writing a letter. First and foremost, just a minute. Okay, so now let's proceed further with letter writing. So as you can see in front of you, you have basically two questions. One is that of an informal letter and the second one is of a formal letter. Now, always remember one thing. Why do we encourage you to go in for a formal letter? The reason is very simple, because it helps to score you better marks. See, understand one thing, when you're attempting a formal letter, first and foremost, the content is going to be very limited because your entire letter is going to be restricted to certain, you know, words, certain discussions. But when you write an informal letter, so you have these greetings that you'll have to write first. Then you have to, you know, write it in a very informal manner because you are writing it to a friend or you're writing it to your parents or to your siblings. So the language becomes a little informal. Of course, with greetings and you have the hi, hello, it's been so long that I haven't seen you or I haven't heard anything from you. So these words, you know, take up not only a lot of space, but also a lot of your time. So always remember, writing a formal letter, you know, it is first and foremost, the content is really restricted. You cannot write like, okay, I haven't seen you in a long time, because right now you're writing this particular letter to someone you don't know, who's a person who's of a superior authority to you. So your content is going to be very restricted. And that is why smaller content, restricted content, limited number of words. And in spite of, you know, so many restrictions also, you end up getting better marks in a formal letter than an informal letter, right? So it is always encouraged to go in for a formal letter than an informal letter because it is more scoring. Now, first and foremost, you all need to be thorough with the format of the address, because in a formal letter, be it a formal letter or an informal letter, your format carries marks. So if your format is incorrect, then be rest assured you are going to lose marks. So you have to ensure that the format you're writing in the letter is absolutely correct. If it's a formal letter, the tone has to be really polite. It has to be really polite. You cannot, even if it's a complaint letter, you cannot have an aggressive, you cannot have an angry tone to your letter. You need to be really very polite when it comes to writing a formal letter. Again, in an informal letter, you are not allowed to use slangs. You are not allowed to use faulty languages. You are not allowed to use SMS, your WhatsApp language. Okay, if you want to say the word did not, it has to be did not and not didn't. It is not and not isn't. No contractions are allowed. So be very careful about these minute mistakes. In today's time, we tend to, you know, type more on WhatsApp rather than writing a paper. And this can happen. So be very, very careful about it, that you all are not resorting to any kind of faulty language or SMS language. Your language has to be pretty polite and decent throughout your letter, be it formal or informal. Now, if you're writing a formal letter, if it's a complaint letter or a suggestion letter, you have to address, you have to highlight the problem and then give an adequate solution to it. So talk about the problem, discuss the problem, what is causing the problem, and probably then come up with a suggestion for that. So come up with a solution. So understand the problem, discuss the problem, and come up with a solution. Okay. And yes, whenever you're writing a formal letter, it has to be precise language. You need to be very clear with what you're writing. You cannot write a confusing letter. You need to be very particular with the kind of words that you are using. Okay, be careful about it. Again, the same thing over here, that you cannot you know, use faulty languages. And yes, another thing is ensure good use of vocabulary. your vocabulary matters over here. Good usage of word definitely matters over here. So be very careful about it. Another thing, whenever you're writing salutations, okay, always make use of the word sir or madam. No ma'am is allowed. It is sir or madam. Okay, in the address also, if you want to write down the month, it is not going to be February ka F-E-B. It has to be the entire word February. It is not December ka D-E-C. It has to be the entire word December. No shortcuts and no short forms. Be very careful about these things. Okay, now let us have a look at your letter right now. So this is exactly the format. In a friendly letter, that's an informal letter, you have the address, you have the date, you have the salutation. Now, then you're going to just, begin with your entire paragraph, subscription, and your first name. So in a informal letter, yours lovingly and your first name. Whereas in a formal letter, you have from address, you have the date, you have the two address. That's the sender's and the receiver's address. You're going to write on both. Then dear sir or madam, then your three body. And then you have your subscription, yours sincerely or yours faithfully. Go in for yours sincerely or yours truly. Avoid the word faithfully if possible. Even if you write, that's not a problem at all. And finally, your name and the surname or just the initial. Even that's absolutely okay. So this is exactly the kind of format and the way you are going to present your letter. Remember, after writing address, leave a line, then the date, leave a line. Then if you're writing the receiver's address, after writing that, leave a line. Then again, you have dear sir or madam. You start with the first para, introduce yourself, leave a line, the body, leave a line, conclusion, leave a line, thanking you, leave a line, yours faithfully or yours sincerely or yours truly, your name and your surname. No signatures, no email ID required. Please do not sign at the end of the letter. It is not required. Okay, come on. Let's proceed further then. So this is just an example of a formal letter right in front of y'all. So as y'all can see, we have the address in four lines, leave a line, the date, leave a line. Then we have the receiver's address, leave a line, salutation, respected sir or dear sir, both are okay. Write dear sir or madam, avoid respected sir also. First para, leave a line, second para, leave a line, third para, and then thanking you in anticipation, leave a line, and then yours sincerely and your name. Sincerely or truly is absolutely fine. So this is exactly how your letter should look on paper. Now, the third question here we have is a notice and an email. Okay, so always remember, in a notice and an email, for notice specifically, you need to know the NDTV format. It's the name, date, time, and venue. Okay, for notice writing, you need to have a creative tagline to it. How do you create a creative tagline? You can just add an adjective before that, before the event, and this is how you write a creative tagline. A creative tagline is very, very important. After that, we have the name, what is exactly the event all about, then the date, then the time, and then the venue. Remember, a notice is basically inviting students for a particular event or putting up a notice regarding something. So your language has to be very polite. The same goes in for an email. Remember, an email is written to a superior authority, to a person quite senior to you, quite superior to you. It can be a principal, it can be the principal, or it can be any superior authority. So you have to ensure that your language is really very polite. You cannot, again, same in email, no slang languages are to be written, no WhatsApp language, nothing, no contractions. You have to be very, very polite when it comes to writing an email as well as a notice. Okay. So these are certain things that you'll have to remember. Okay, whenever you're writing a notice, a tagline, y'all can just put in an exclamatory mark in order to highlight the tagline. This is what you'll all need to follow. So again, we have the tagline, then the name, then the date, the time and the venue. In order to make your notice look really neat and you know, quite presentable, always enclose a notice in a box. Okay, always enclose a notice in a box. This is how your notice is going to look more compressed and it is going to look more neat. So in a box, you write down the tagline, then the name, date, time and venue, and find your information. Enclose your notice in a box. You need not enclose an email in the box. You need not enclose the email in the box. Just the notice is enough. One more thing, whenever you're writing email, you need to divide your email in three paragraphs. Just like letter writing, your email should also be divided into three paragraphs. So the first paragraph is your introduction. Who are you and what's the purpose for you writing the email? Second paragraph, give details of the reason why you're writing the email. Third paragraph, what are you expecting from the person to whom you're writing the email? Okay, so first paragraph is your introduction. Second paragraph is going to talk about your information that you need to provide in the email. And finally, the last paragraph is going to be about what you're expecting from the person to whom you're writing the email. Again, leave a line. You will have your salutations. Yours faithfully, yours truly, yours sincerely, your name. In email, you will also add the designation. For example, if it's a head boy, head girl, cultural secretary, and so on. Designation after your name is mandatory when it comes to email writing. These are certain things that you'll need to remember when it comes to writing an email. So see over here also, we need a creative title for your notice. Okay, then the name, date, time, venue, and to whom, like who are you addressing this notice to. Then in an email ID has to be mentioned. Then you have the subject, salutation as the same as in a formal letter, that's dear sir or madam. You have the opening sentence. What's an opening sentence? Basically, who are you and why are you writing this email? Closing sentences, basically, what are you expecting from the person to whom you're writing the email? We have the subscription, that is yours faithfully, truly, sincerely. Okay. Now, expression, remember, whenever you're writing an email, it needs to be in proper full sentences in a very polite language. Okay, mention all the details. Like, so for example, you have to write an email basically on the question where you are written a notice. So whatever details you have mentioned in the notice, write it neatly and carefully in the email also. Remember, once again, the language, the tone of your words are going to matter really. So ensure that the words you're writing are in a very polite manner. Clear? Now, we'll proceed further. So this is exactly how a notice and an email should look in your paper. If you enclose a notice in a box, it is going to look even more presentable. This is exactly how you have to write a notice and an email in the paper. Now, coming on to question number 4, it is the comprehension. Now, this is one question where, you know, students fail to understand the very first A part given. That is, how do you understand the meaning of these words? Now, I just teach you a very simple trick for that. Now, for example, the very first word is assigned, line number 3. Now, exactly how a student is supposed to find the meaning of this particular word, I'll just show you all exactly in that manner. I don't know the meaning of the word. I'm going to read the paragraph and I'm going to try understanding what exactly is the meaning of this word. For example, attending classes inside a railway carriage seemed unusual enough, but the seating arrangements turned out to be unusual too. At Toto Chan's previous school, each pupil was assigned a specific desk, but here they could sit anywhere they liked at any time. At Toto Chan's previous school, each pupil was assigned a specific desk. Assigned a specific desk. Now, what I've done is, I am trying reading that word again and again in the given sentence to understand in what context has the word been used over here. So what I can understand from the word is, was assigned a specific desk means it was given. So the very simple word of this word assigned is given. Exactly in the same manner, you are going to try, you know, reading these statements exactly like this and then try understanding the the usage of the word in that particular statement. Because as you all know, in English, one word can have different meanings, right? So you will just have to read the sentence again and again, again and again, maybe 3-4 times you might have to read it in order to try understanding exactly in what context has the word been used. Only then you'll be able to gauge the correct meaning. Okay, so this is what you'll have to remember. Okay, whenever you all are writing answers, you are attempting question answers, please understand one thing, that you have to first and foremost think logically about these answers and then frame it in your own words. You have to really remember one thing, that you cannot be just copywriting answers. You will have to frame them in your own words, and only then you're going to write them. If you're just going to lift the answer from the passage and you're going to write it as it is, it won't actually make sense. You won't even get marks in that. In comprehension, you have to answer the question logically. You have to read the question carefully. You have to read your passage carefully. And let me tell you, by just reading the passage once, if you think that, you know, you'll be able to answer all the questions correctly, that is not going to happen. You will have to read the answers read the comprehension quite a few times in order to exactly understand what is the comprehension all about, and only then attempt answering the questions. At least a maximum of 3 times you have to read the comprehension. It's minimum 2 and maximum 3. You won't have time beyond that also. So remember, minimum 2 times, but maximum 3 times you have to read the comprehension. Only then you'll be able to understand exactly how you have to answer these questions. Okay. So always remember, answering a question has to be in your own words. You cannot just copy paste. Then when we come on to pressy writing, it's an 8-mark question, a very important question. Now in a pressy writing, basically you will be asked in the question to summarize a particular part of the comprehension. When we say the word summarize, it does not mean you just pick up a paragraph from the passage, just eliminate a few words and you're going to write a pressy. No, it's summary writing. So first and foremost, you need to understand that part of the comprehension that you have to summarize. Read it well. Read it twice. Says again, a minimum of 2 and a maximum of 3 times. Read it well. You need to read them really, really well. And then summarize the pressy in your own words. You may look for keywords. You may look for words that are standing out in the passage. And you are going to use these words in your pressy. You can eliminate adjectives, you can eliminate extra words, you can eliminate adverbs, you can join two sentences and you can write a sentence. That's all okay. That's absolutely okay. But you have to write down the summary in your own words. Your pressy has to be written in your own words. You cannot copy paste it from the passage. Only then you will be able to score 8 on 8 in pressy. Again, when you write down a pressy, you will have to make a rough grid. You will have to make a fair grid. In rough grid, the entire grid will be made with a pencil, and you will cancel the rough grid. If you do not cancel the rough grid, you will not get marks. So please remember, your rough grid is going to be drawn with a pencil. Draw with a pencil, write with a pencil. Whereas your fair draft, you can draw it with a pencil, or you can draw it with a pen for that matter and write it with a pen. You can actually write your entire fair draft in pen. You can even draw the boxes with a pen. And when you're writing a rough grid, it has to be completely with a pencil. You cannot even touch the pen at that point of time. So rough draft completely with pencil, fair draft completely with pen. The moment your rough draft is in pen, you directly get wrong and it's a 0 for you. Rough draft with a pencil and fair draft with a pen. Remember these 2 rules. Rough draft with a pencil, scratch the rough draft once it is ready, and then make your fair draft. This is basically the marking scheme for the 3 meanings that you write correctly. Even if you write the word nearest to that meaning, you will still get 3 marks in that. Okay, then you have your question answers. Again, the moment you write them all by yourself, only then you're going to get marks in that. I will not suggest you all to just copyright it from the passage. That's not how it is supposed to be done. Okay, and then finally we have the pressy writing. You can score full marks in this particular comprehension, provided you understand the importance of reading the comprehension and you understand the importance of writing the comprehension in your own words. This is exactly how comprehension should look. See how neatly these words, the meanings have been written. Okay. And after every answer in the five questions, after every answer, the line has been left. You've left line everywhere. So this is how neatly your paper should look. Okay. This is how the neatness should be maintained throughout the paper. See, again over here, we have created the rough draft. Now what we've done is, we've written the rough draft in a separate page and the fair draft in a separate page. The moment our rough draft was ready, we cancelled it and then we had the fair draft. This is exactly how your pressy should look in the paper also. Now, when we come to grammar part, see, as far as your verbs are concerned, you need to be thorough with your tenses. The 12 different types of tenses and their usage. Another thing, now this is not a foolproof, trick that we can say, but yes, always in the question 5A, that's your verb part, always have a look at the very first verb that has been given to you all. Check the tense of that particular verb. Now, majority of the time, the first word, whichever tense it is in, the rest of the paragraph also is in the same tense. Now, this does not happen always, but yes, sometimes that does happen. Or you can always try, fitting in that particular tense. So, suppose if the first word, now it is in past tense. So, whatever next words that you are going to attempt, try fitting in the past tense of the verb first. If that fits, it's perfect. If that doesn't fit, then yes, you may try any other tense. So, this is like one little thing that you all should know about verbs. Rest, you should be thorough with your 12 tenses. Prepositions, appropriate word. You need to know your prepositions really well. The usage of on, into, inside, in, then before, after. You need to know during, since, from, for. You should be thorough with the usage of these prepositions. And let me tell you, if you want to excel in question number 5, trust me, the more you practice papers, the more you practice sentences, only then you will be able to get an idea of the different kind of sentences that can be asked in the paper. Now that your exams are nearing, at least as far as language paper is concerned, even if not every day, at least 3 days in a week, try solving grammar papers. The more grammar you solve, the better you'll get at it. That's the only way you can excel in a language paper. For writing skills also, you need to understand one thing, that you need to read. You need to read, and then you probably can just write down whatever you have read and then practice on that. Practice. Now it's a time where you should be solving papers. So for language, at least I'll tell you all one thing, practice papers. As many papers as you all can practice, start practicing them. At least 3 papers in a week should be dedicated to language. Only then you'll be able to understand, are you, scoring well in grammar? What part of the paper are you losing marks? Okay, and revise your grammar lessons in RoboMate. They are going to really help you. Whenever you're solving grammar paper, before you start solving, just go through the grammar concepts given in RoboMate and then sit to practice. Even if you watch the RoboMate video 10 times, that's okay. Watch it the 11th time, watch it the 15th time. Have a look at the video, revise the concept, and only then sit for your solving the sentences. Only then you'll be able to score good marks in it. Okay, and always remember one thing. As far as your language paper is concerned, you are going to, when you start writing your paper, there are chances that you'll get so engrossed in writing skills that you will lose track of time and you're going to waste a lot of time. So for that also, you need to time yourself in your writing paper. So once you start the paper, you should be sure of one thing, that 20 minutes are over. So your question number 1 is over. you cannot exceed time in this particular paper here, because remember, any minute that you delay or you take extra time in writing a question, your second question is getting delayed and you won't get extra time. And remember, you need at least 10 minutes to go through your paper. You need time to read what you've written and you need time to make necessary corrections. So be very, very careful about it. Time is going to be a very important factor in your language paper, and especially in writing skills part. Students tend to spend one hour in just a very first question. Avoid that. You spend 1 hour, you spend 2.5 hours, you spend the entire day. If the question is of 20 marks, you're going to get marks out of 20 only. That does not mean, no matter how good a content you've written, you're not going to get marks beyond 20. So always remember that you need to control your time limit. Your time should be controlled by you this time, and you should be able to finish all your questions in the allotted time. You cannot exceed the time limit. The moment you're exceeding your time limit, the second question gets affected. Okay, so as far as, you know, again, over here also the same suggestions have been given, that you need to understand the importance of reading. Even when you're solving grammar sentences, read the sentence carefully. Before you decide the answer, read the sentence, or be it verb, be it preposition, be it conjunctions, you need to read the sentence carefully. Another thing, whenever you're solving synthesis of sentences, now whenever you have contradictory sentences where you have to use the conjunctions like though, although, even though, it is seen that students are also using the conjunction yet along with it. Like, for example, although he was late, yet he was allowed to give the exam. So you are making use of two conjunctions over here, although and yet. So please remember one thing, yet is an independent conjunction. So either you can use although in the sentence or you can use yet. You cannot use both the conjunctions. So be careful about that. You can either use although or you can either use yet. And please remember, you do not have to use and, but, and so. Students end up using and, but, and so. But please, you're not supposed to use that. And again, if you want to excel in grammar, if you want to excel in writing skills, the only mantra to success is read, 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 and practice. The more papers you practice, the better you'll get at it. That's the only way of excelling in your language paper. So I hope this particular session was really helpful to y'all. And I hope all your doubts have been cleared as far as your language paper is concerned. Okay. Remember, read the question well, understand the question well, talk in English at home, write in English. And then, you know, like, let English be an integral part of your life now. Let English be an integral part of your life, and only then you'll be able to excel in your English paper. Remember, the more you are using English at home, the more you're writing in English, the more you're reading English, the more you're watching, you know, like any particular movie in English, it's going to always help to enhance and increase your vocabulary. And this is exactly what is needed when it comes to writing a language paper. Your vocabulary plays a key role in your writing skills, in your letter, in your notice, in your email, and then your thorough understanding of grammar concepts. Okay, so I wish you all the luck for your upcoming language paper, and do take these suggestions into note and start working on them, right? So wishing you all the very best for your examination, guys. And remember one thing, run behind efforts. Do not run behind marks. If you run behind marks, you'll just focus on the marks and not on the efforts. But remember, it's always the other way around. The moment you start focusing on your efforts, that's when you're going to achieve great success in life. Focus on the efforts, and I'm sure of one thing, you all are going to rock your paper, right? So with this, I hope to see you all really very soon. Bye guys, take care, and please don't forget to be safe. Thank you so much.